Okay, 10 years ago, this Sunday, our country was dealt a horrific blow. And when something like that happens, it's easy to hate. But hate will eat you up. This man I want to introduce to you right now is a man who's overcome all that, and he is a living example of what it is to live a purposeful and meaningful life. Let's have a nice warm welcome for Mr. John Paul DeVito.
Just keep in mind, the people that I was with that day, there were 14. I was a chief operating officer of a minority firm that had 70 employees. 40 were present that day. As a chief operating officer of a brokerage firm, I like to be the first in, the last out. So, I got to the firm always, the earliest. And, interesting about the World Trade Center Tower 1, and I was on the 87th floor that day. When you enter the building, you have to take two elevator banks to get to the 87th floor. So just keep in mind that you have to take an elevator from the first floor to the 78, and then you have to exit to get the balance of the elevator banks to go from 78 to the 87th floor. Just keep that in mind, because you'll understand that as we progress with this little chat. When I got to the office, I was the first one there. It was around 7 o'clock, 7:30-ish. And as chief operating officer of a brokerage firm, right, we just prepared for that day. Check some emails, look at trading positions. And I had an investment banking client that was arriving. He was scheduled to be there at 9 o'clock. His name is Ed Fine. It's kind of interesting with his name. And Ed arrived early. And, security from the World Trade Center called me up and said to me, your visitor is early. Do you mind if he comes up early? I could have been a pompous asshole. I could have had the person wait in the lobby because it was scheduled for a different time. I said, have Ed come up. So Ed came up. He went. We started our meeting in the conference room. He had some underlying companies that he wanted to finance. As being chief operating officer of the firm, he had to go through me before he would go to the investment bankers. We had a very disruptive meeting. Some of his transactions made sense. And I escorted Ed to the elevator bank so he could make his descent and leave. Got back to my office, sat down, and just normal course of the day. And then it happened. The steel workers say that steel sings. And one of the things you should know is that what a magnificent building. It had music to it. You would hear it sway. You would hear it swing. It was absolutely amazing. For 2 years, looking out that, I had a corner office overlooking the Hudson, the Statue of Liberty, the traffic, the air traffic that was below me was amazing on a daily basis. It was a magnificent and beautiful building. But when it happened, I was sitting at my desk, and I'll never forget the intense shock. It shocked me to my left, to my right, and back to my left. The entire building moved 3 times. You knew something occurred. Immediately, all the windows were blown out. Tiles were cascading upon us. Again, there were 70 people who worked for me. Only 14 people were there. Smoke started rushing into the office. I gathered my 14 employees in front of me. And I said to them, listen, something occurred. Everyone stay here. Let me leave the office and let me see what the status of the balance of the floor was like. So while I left, you can imagine what certain employees did. They telephone calls. There was a very smart investment bank named Adam room that went and got a gallon of water. I left the office. And I went on to the floor. And what I'm about to do is exactly, I'll just share it. Just take 5 steps, elevate is here, then you walk this way, and it's missing. The entire floor is missing. It is at 87 floors, and the edge is right there, and it's falling. And you're looking, and the neurons are not firing, the synapses are not occurring. You're actually, wow, there's a fire here. And I actually was taking sheetrock and putting out the fire. Then I said to myself, the floor's missing. What are you doing? And you looked, and there was a black void. Just imagine how surreal it must have looked like to see that the floor that you were once there, and that was the balance of that floor, was gone. I rushed back into the office, and they were like children. They were all looking at me. I'll look at the direction. The thing I'm not is a hero. The thing I hate when people say is this H word. I can't even deal with it. I said to the employees, we're in a chapel. I can't say exactly what I said, but you could imagine. I said, we got to get out of here. And I left. Now, when I got back to that floor, the smoke was bellowing in. People started to tell me. So they followed me. And thank God that, you know, to the right wasn't the floor, but to the left, past the yellow banks, there was one remaining stairwell. And we started the descent. The descent from the 87th floor to the 78th floor was, we were the only ones there. Every one of us did not survive. Did we know at that time that the plane had crashed, that we would have been attacked? We didn't know, but we knew there was something devastating occurred. So again, the 87th to the 78th descent, we were the only ones on the sail. There was only 14 of us. Like I mentioned before, on the 78th is where you have to get the other elevator banks. Now, in order to fly drills, we all knew not to take elevators, but when we got to the 78th floor, what occurred was, you know, humanity and pandemonium. You heard announcements, go back, the building is secure. Please, you know, don't panic, go back. There was no doubt that we weren't going back. One gentleman, a Chinese investment banker named Hong Zhu, turned around to me and said, John, I'm going back. I said, Hong, you're not going back. Please. He thought, even though it wasn't the floor, he actually thought about going back. And it's important that you remember Hong Zhu, because you'll understand that as we, you know, continue this little chat that we're having here. And again, I am honored to be here. I am really honored to be here. The 78th floor to, you know, the rest of the descent. Okay, what occurred? Like I said to you, so I'm getting some water. Down the water. And what did we do? You know, handicapped people took priority. Burn victims took priority. The elderly took priority. I know, sometimes I wonder, you know, how certain things have occurred in my life and how I've been quoted. And you know, I'm just overwhelmed. But I've said on numerous occasions, unequivocally, I saw the greatness of the world that day. And again, you'd be so honored that everyone was helping everyone. No one was pushing. No one was shoving. No one was saying, my life is more important than yours. Completely opposite. Anyone that needed help was given it. Anyone that wanted priority to descend was given. And there was no gender. There was no race. There was no religion. It was just everyone helping each other. And again, me administering water. You know, anybody that needed water, I gave water. The next thing I want to talk to you about is very personal to me. And again, like I said to you, I'm not here. I am not here. I'm a sinner. I'm not here to try to make you get close to God, to make you get closer to Christ. It's way beyond me. But the moment I'm going to see it is my personal moment. And I know what Jesus Christ looks like. And he has the map of Ireland on his face. And he's a New York City father. How do I know that? I know that because of his words. And just have to picture this. It was in the high 40s. He's about 6'3", blonde hair. He's taking off his helmet, profusely sweating, dashed off a fire truck, ran up 50 flights of stairs. He reached out and went, count on water. I had no words. He looked at me and he said two things and he repeated them. I was overwhelmed with his love, his humanity. I stood in a moment of grace.